At the time of the attack on the Capitol, I was in the gallery observing the proceedings on the House floor. While members of Congress were being protected by the police, you, the patriots protecting the Capitol and our very democracy, were being attacked by the mob outside. I want to learn more about what you did and what you witnessed. Officer Fanone, as a narcotics officer, you weren't supposed to be at the Capitol on January 6th, is that right?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
What prompted you to come to the Capitol?
I was listening to the radio transmissions, specifically those coming from now Commander Robert Glover, who was the on-scene commander. If you've listened to those transmissions, he identifies himself as Cruiser 50. I heard things that I'd never heard before in my law enforcement career. In addition to the numerous distress calls or 1033s that I heard, which are, while not commonplace, also not uncommon in policing, I heard things like, the declaration of a citywide 1033. Which in my career, to my recollection, has only been utilized in addition to the 9/11 attacks on the Navy Yard attack. I found that particularly distressful. Also, you could hear the tone of the individual officers' voices. They were scared. They were, clearly outnumbered and being violently assaulted.
Thank you. So basically, the radio traffic, the 1033 signal on the radio, and your basic law enforcement instinct said your fellow comrades needed help, and therefore you made your way along with your friend to the Capitol.
Yes, sir.
So you went anyway. And let me thank you for that, and I understand a number of other people did the same. Officer Hodges, we've seen the harrowing video of you being crushed in a doorway as you bravely fought to keep the mob from breaching the Capitol. Many of your fellow officers' acts of heroism were not captured on video and are not therefore known to the public. Can you please share with the committee other acts of heroism by your colleagues on January 6th that you're aware of?
Absolutely. One of my sergeants, Sergeant Brian Peake, while fighting to maintain control over the barricades on the West Terrace, was struck by a rioter and fractured and severely lacerating his right index finger. He kept in the fight for several more hours after that. He just put some tape on it and a napkin and went back to work. He was there for several hours before finally accepting medical evac. He ended up having to have the tip of his finger removed. Another officer who was out there in the fight with us, he, much like myself, he had a large, heavy object thrown and struck his head. He wasn't as lucky as me, though. He has suffered lost time from that day, and he remains still out on medical leave. Even today, he has not returned to work, but at the time, he was still fighting. Another officer, he was fought on the West Terrace, and in the tunnel was instrumental to the defense. After being completely soaked with OC spray, was shocked several times by a cattle prod one of the terrorists brought with them. When I went over my testimony, my opening statement before, I mentioned that we were attacked outside the secondary defense line on the West Terrace. And after we rallied there, we continued onward. I know that another officer found a Capitol Police officer who was being dragged out into the crowd. And he was unable to signal to us what was going on. So he charged in there by himself and got that officer back out of there. And in the process, hyperextended his knee and took several other injuries. The Washington Post and Carnegie Mellon University have estimated there were about 9,400 terrorists out there, and I would say we had about 150, 175 officers. So any one of them could tell you any amounts of heroic acts or injuries they sustained, but these are just a few that I know of.
Thank you very much. Officer Gunnell, you talked about your tour in Iraq and what have you, and thank you for your service. Can you give the committee a sense of comparing that those tours and experiences with what you experienced on January 6th?
Sure. Back when I was in Iraq and sometime on a convoy mission to provide mutual support or taking care packages or whatnot to my other units and detachment and whatnot, we went through roadside bomb infested IED and whatnot, convoys and whatnot. And my fear were minimal that around that time. It was not as constant. I know we knew at that time that we could run over an IED and that was it, but at least we knew that we were in a combat zone. Here in our country, in our very own capital, we are being attacked. Not once, but multiple times we had.
Can you pull the microphone to you just a little bit?
Not only we were attacked one time, but it was multiple times over and over, different people. They hit us and then they got tired of hitting us and then they switch, somebody else rotating in and out. And as my colleagues also has said, we were at the lowest entrance tunnel and we didn't have a chance to rotate ourselves until later on, like after an hour and a half later. So whoever was there, we were fighting for our lives. We were fighting to protect all of you. In our mind, that time at that entrance, that was it. That was the point of breach, and we were not letting them in. They tried to convert us. They tried to persuade us to let them in, yelling. And then once they saw that we were not doing that, then continued to even attack us even more. And it was nonstop. So my time compared to Iraq, totally different. This is our own citizens, people who we sworn an oath to protect, but yet they are attacking us with the same flag that they claim to represent. It was bad.
Thank you. Officer Dunn, you talked about being called the N-word. You talked about being talked about like you've never heard before. And you talked about sharing comments from your other colleagues as well as the seeing of the Confederate flag and other things carried through the Capitol. As an African-American law enforcement officer, can you give us, this committee and those who are watching, how you felt defending the Capitol on that day, being called that and seeing the symbols of the Confederacy going through the Capitol at the same time?
Yes, sir. Thank you for your question. To be frank, while the attack was happening, I didn't view it, and I wasn't able to process it as a racial attack. I was just trying to survive that day and get home. When I did have a moment to process it, I think that's in the rotunda where I became so emotional because I was able to process everything that happened. And it was just so overwhelming and it's so disheartening and disappointing that we live in a country with people like that, that attack you because of the color of your skin, just to hurt you. Those words are weapons. Thankfully, at the moment, it didn't hinder me from doing my job. But once I was able to process it, it hurt. It hurt just reading it now and just thinking about it, that people demonize you because of the color of your skin. When my blood is red, I'm an American citizen. I'm a police officer. I'm a peace officer. I'm here to defend this country, defend everybody in this building, not just the members, all the staff, guests, everybody. It just hurts that we have people in this country that result to that, regardless of your actions and what you desire to do and to make a difference out there. It's disheartening, so.
Thank you, but because of your heroism on that day, lives were saved and our democracy was preserved in large part because you gave y'all, all of you, for that day on January 6th. I assure you this committee will ensure there's a comprehensive account of your heroic acts of that day. And your testimony this morning is an essential part of that record. Thank you for your service to this country and for coming before us today.